Welcome, welcome, welcome to another virtual morning service at the Met. We are so excited. It's Young Adult Weekend once again.
This is the fifth annual EPIC Young Adult Sunday. And just to remind everyone, EPIC stands for Encouraging Purpose.
We're so grateful to have you here with us today. We've got so many special guests and surprises planned throughout the service. Thank you again for spending your Sunday with us, because when you come our way, you make it our day.
Now, what's up with that, young folk? Y'all took my word, those pastors' word. When you come our way, you make our day. But either way, I resonate with their welcome, for this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to Metropolitan Today, our worship service for this EPIC Sunday 2020. Would you join now as we sing together this wonderful hymn? We love hymns here at Metropolitan. And this hymn was rendered on the occasion of the pastor's 40th year in ministry celebration. We sang it wonderfully, we sang it lustily, but we sing it in full power of our Lord. Jesus is all the world to me. We'll sing it together, after which Sister Renee Cox will lead us in our affirmation of faith.
Thank you. Good morning. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now reverently and sincerely declare the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning, church family. One of the great traditions of the Metropolitan AME Zion Church is the singing of the anthems during worship services on Sunday morning. This is the time when Sister Ingrid directs the melodious singing of the choir and Sister Doris skillfully plays our pipe organ as if it's a multi-piece orchestra. Having grown up in the church, I have developed an appreciation for the anthems and have impressed myself with my abilities to recall various classics and composers when I've heard them at concerts and choral events. This morning's anthem is a favorite of mine. It's titled, "And He Blessed My Soul," written by composer Anita Stevens Watkins. I trust you'll enjoy it as much as I do. After the singing of the anthem, our scripture reading for this morning will be read by Sister Shannon Rohn.
Just one look at Jesus, and my cares will all pass away. Only one look was all. Just one look at Jesus, and my cares will all pass away.
My soul, and he blessed my soul. Today's reading will be from the New International Version, Luke 10, 30 through 35. In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, took him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have.'" The word of God.
Beloved, prayer is always in order, and the order of the day. You will notice by now our young adults who are taking the lead in our worship experience today. You have seen them all over the place, from their virtual welcome where they took my words all the way through the entirety of the service. Today, our prayer centering moment is your grace and mercy has brought us through. All of us can relate to that in the midst of this pandemic, for without God, we never would have made it. And we're delighted today to welcome to our service the Reverend G. Wesley Delavan, one of the associate ministers of the Walters Memorial AME Zion Church, Bridgeport, Connecticut, and a young adult who will lead us in our talk with the Lord.
Your grace and mercy brought me through. I'm living this moment because of you. I want to thank you and praise you too. Your grace and mercy brought me through. For Jesus, your grace and mercy brought me through. I'm living this moment because of you. I wanna thank you and praise you too. Oh Lord, yeah.
As we prepare to go to the throne of grace this morning, we thank God for this another opportunity to call upon the name of Jesus. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, once more and again that we come first to give you thanks and glory for your grace and mercy. It's your grace and mercy that continues to keep us in this season and in this pandemic. But God, we thank you for another opportunity to call upon your holy and righteous name. Lord, we thank you for this epic weekend. In spite of it all, we thank you for these faithful young adults, God, who have determined that they would continue to serve you even in the midst of this pandemic. God, we thank you for another opportunity to enter into your presence and call upon your holy and righteous name. So now we ask that you would continue to cover us with your grace and mercy. We thank you for your grace and mercy because it's your grace and mercy that continues to keep us, that continues to protect us, and most of all, continues to sustain us. Lord, we pray now that you would bless the Metropolitan AME Zion Church. Bless Presiding Elder Terry L. Jones, God, as he continues not only to lead the Met, God, but as he leads this district. Continue to give him the strength, God. Bless his family. Lord, bless this epic service, that somebody would be drawn closer to you through what and all that is said and done in this worship experience. God, we yield our spirits to you now. We thank you for another opportunity to enter into your sanctuary. And we thank you for another opportunity to call upon your holy and righteous name. God, we pray that you would forgive us of our sins, thoughts, words, and deeds, and try us one more time. That as we as young adults continue to serve you in this present age, our calling to fulfill, that you would be pleased with our service. God, we pray that during and in spite of COVID-19 and not being able to gather, but we are still serving you. And so God, we pray now that you would end this season that we're in. Bless each young adult, God. Touch us afresh, God.
that when we come out of this COVID-19, that we would serve you the better. We would give you the best that we can. God, we pray for the word on today. We pray that you would speak a word, that somebody would be saved, that somebody's heart would be healed, but most of all, that you would get the glory. Have your way in this service. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
We are encouraged by that prayer, Reverend Delavan. Thank you for talking to the Lord on our behalf. Today, again, is Epic Sunday 2020, and we are so glad you have joined us virtually in our service. We are delighted to welcome to the preachment moment today one of my young mentees. He left me a year or so ago and tried the reins of fabulous New York after having served at our church at Danbury, Connecticut, the Mount Pleasant Church. He's a powerful young preacher, a budding young cleric who's on his way up in our Zion. He is the Reverend Quavon Z. Newton, Ashley's husband, Eden's father, and he is the good pastor of the Rush Temple AME Zion Church in Jamaica, New York. After the singing of the Midwinter National Yakim Choir that sang during our meeting in December 2019 down in DC, one more sunny day, would you hear the preacher and would you hear the word of God? Amen.
Break it down. Good morning and God bless. I am blessed to be able to sit here in my house where I know God is as well. He is omnipresent. He's not only in the church house, but I believe that he is meeting us right in our houses as we worship today virtually. I am blessed and honored to be the speaker for this fifth annual Epic Young Adult Sunday. I am still desiring to come over to the Met and to preach in that wonderful pulpit in that great church. So although I feel good that I can, you know, virtually be able to deliver the word at the Met, I am still waiting for my presiding elder. They say your first presiding elder is always your presiding elder. I'm still waiting for my presiding elder to tell me we need you to come on down to Hartford. So after today, if this blesses you, just hit his inbox, his DM, send him a text message and say, when we get back in, have Reverend Newton come there. And I'm also excited for the future fellowship to when you all will come down to Jamaica, New York. I am Reverend Quavon Newton, who's a pastor of the Rush Temple AME Zion Church in Jamaica, New York. I want to give honor again to the presiding elder, pastor, the Reverend Dr. Terry L. Jones Sr., who is a great leader. I've learned so much about leadership from him, and I am forever grateful. And one of the nicest, most loving first ladies in the world. First Lady Jones, we honor you as well. To Yakim at the Met, who's one of the most active young adult ministries that we have. So I'm blessed to see all that you do. My boy TJ, thank you for extending the invite. There is a word from the Lord, and it is found in Luke, the 10th chapter. You can turn there with me. Luke, the 10th chapter, we will begin at verse 30. If you're turning there with me, just type in the comment section. Hold on, Pastor, I'm trying to find it. If you have been in quarantine now with all of us for, I believe, 9-10 weeks now, and you have not been able to locate your Bible since it began, just say, pray for me. Say, pray for me. If you ain't going to turn there, you're just going to listen to me read it, just type in the comment section, go ahead, preacher. God bless you. Thank you for your honesty. Luke, the 10th chapter, beginning at verse number 30, it reads, in reply, Jesus said a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he had came to the place and saw him, passed on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him, went to him, and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any expense you may have. The Lord had a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. I'm going to be using briefly on this Sunday morning as a thought of discussion, the topic to be preached, the path, the trail, and the highway. The path, the trail, and the highway. Join me in a quick word of prayer. Lord God, we thank you for the word. I believe that this word is needed for in this time and season, but I need you to work within so that your words can come out. Let this be a word that not just sounds good for the moment, but it changes an aspect of our lives. It alters the way we think. It strengthens, encourages, and increases faith. This is our prayer, and by faith we believe it's done in Jesus' name. Amen. The path, the trail, and the highway. This story of the Good Samaritan is by no surprise only included in Luke's account of the gospel. for Luke writes to a Gentile audience with the goal of revealing Jesus as being the rejected prophet. The Gentiles were now included in the family of this new Christian movement, but this inclusion wasn't accepted amongst all Jews. Because many of the Jews who believed that they were special and privileged in God's eyes did not believe that the Gentiles were now a part of God's elect. Luke takes it a bit further as he emphasizes social justice and a reversal of those who were rejected, struggling, or less fortunate, becoming those who are now accepted, helped, and blessed. Which is why Luke makes it a point to note Jesus' words in the Sermon on the Plain, that blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. There's also a strong emphasis on the journey and specific route of Jesus leading to the temple of Jerusalem. And to answer this lawyer's inquiry in the text on who is my neighbor, Jesus uses this story that we have titled The Good Samaritan. But the background of this man, it wasn't given to us. We don't know where he was coming from or why he was on the journey to Jericho. We don't know if this man was married or if he was single. We don't know if he was on a chore at night, at hours that didn't make any sense, given to him by his wife. Let me stop getting personal. We don't know that. Or if he was out late night as a single man trying to fulfill a call. You'll get it maybe when you get back to the church. We often discuss the Good Samaritan, but we hardly ever consider this from the perspective of what's considered to be this Jewish man who was robbed, beaten, and left for dead along his journey. This man was on his way from Jerusalem to Jericho. Jerusalem means a city of peace. So we know that he was on his way from his place of peace. And Jericho means his moon. So it's the light that shines through darkness before a new day. He was on a path that seemed foolish to be making in the dark, because the journey from Jerusalem to Jericho was about 16 miles. And not only that, but you have to get through three different towns and go around the long way, because there was no direct route from Jerusalem to Jericho. So in the time of Jesus, the road from Jerusalem to Jericho was notorious for its danger and difficulty. In fact, it was known as the Way of Blood because of the blood which was often shed there by robbers. Theologian William Barclay once wrote that, and I quote, "He was an obviously reckless and foolhardy character. People seldom attempted the Jericho to Jerusalem road alone. If they were carrying goods or valuables, seeking safety in numbers, they traveled in convoys or caravans. He says this man had no one but himself to blame for the plight in which he found himself," unquote. But to me, it seems clear that yes, this man was enjoying his peace, and now for some reason journeying his way through the darkness. But he wasn't concerned, because along the way, he knew that there were people who had the ability to guide him through safety. The priest and Levite are mentioned in this text because they were the most frequent travelers on this road. But interestingly, the first ones who saw this man and left him were those who had the ability to assist, the knowledge of God's grace and mercy, and the belief that God blesses those who blesses others. But perhaps maybe we shouldn't judge them. Perhaps they had some legitimate excuses. Perhaps they said, I'm just a young adult. What do you expect me to do? Well, the road is too dangerous for me to stop and to help this man. I've got to get to the temple, got to get to the church and perform my services for the Lord. And if I'm going to serve at the temple or the church, I can't get my clothes dirty. Or I'm the only one and this job is too big or very popular. I can pray for him. He brought it on himself. He should have never been on that road alone in the first place. Or someone, I love this one, someone should help that man. There's a story about four people named Everybody, Somebody, Anybody, and Nobody. There was an important job to be done and everybody was sure that somebody would do it. Anybody could have done it, but nobody did it. Somebody got angry about that because it was everybody's job. Everybody thought that anybody could do it, but nobody realized that everybody wouldn't do it. It ended up that everybody blamed somebody when nobody did what anybody could have. Isn't it something that there are people who have the ability, but no concern to actually use it to assist someone in need? Not on this stream or not on this YouTube, it's all right. Maybe on the other stream at the other church. But there are people somewhere who have the knowledge but refuse to be a mentor to someone else. Who have the ideas but would rather gossip and complain about what's going wrong instead of working for a solution to make things right. Who have been blessed with the talents and abilities but won't use them for God or too lazy to even work for themselves. Who have the finances but no desire to bless God nor those in need. This man thought that as he went from peace to trying something new that he would be covered, but the ones who could have helped just went on with their lives and left him there. Let me ask, are there moments in your life where you are the one who have the ability but refuse to offer your talents, resources, or gifts? Maybe the young adult in the church who have the ability, have the talents to push this ministry even further, but you choose to just sit and be a part. God might be saying to you that it's time to move. This man was going down a path. Promise you, give me just a few more moments to remain calm, and I'm going to go right back to my couch and watch my Netflix. This man was going down a path. A path is a way that is made by continual treading. There are some of us who have to go through the hard way in order for the path to be clear for someone else. Now, I know this is not for everybody. Not everybody has a story. But I believe that there's some who can testify that I didn't always have it easy. But my testimony is that I made it through by any means. That I didn't allow excuses to hinder me from chasing my dreams or getting where I believe God could take me. Now, things weren't always easy, but I was determined. And you might be the first one to graduate from college in your family. You might be the first one to have a lucrative career or to start your own business. You might be the first to be active in a church. But if we were to be honest, there are some nights when you wanted to give it up. There's some nights when you wanted to withdraw from school. When you wanted to just walk away from the job. Or times when melanin-colored folk made you want to say, I'm through with the church. And if it wasn't for God who has been working on you, at times your response might have made things worse. Because people whom you thought would be there have let you down. People whom you thought would be on your side, right there with you, were the ones talking about you behind your back. But some of you have the testimony that I'm not perfect, but I'm still a child of God. That God, I'm glad that you're still working on me because I'm saved, but I still have a temper. I'm trying to be like Jesus, but he's still working on me every single day. And love conquers all, but it's hard to let go of some things and to turn the other cheek. That I can scream hallelujah, but there are some words that I might use if you get me messed up. But God is still working on me. And though it's been hard on the path, some of you might have been feeling like this man in our text who've been robbed along the way, who's been beaten by life, who's been left alone on your journey, that you've learned after it all that you're strong enough to overcome it. When people have walked away from you and turned their backs on you, you learn that you didn't need them anyhow. Because if God wanted them in my life, then they would still be here. So I'm not going to cry about who left or walked away. I'm going to thank God for what's still here. After it all, you've learned that you're strong enough to overcome what's before you. Just give me about a few more minutes. I'm about to take, about to shut the computer off. A preacher has 3 times to say that before they are serious. That's my first time. A trail is a mark or a series of signs or objects that's left behind by the passage of someone or something. This good Samaritan was there to help. He was there after the priest and the Levite just walked past. But this is a unique case because the Jews, they hated Samaritans to such a degree that they destroyed the Samaritan's temple on Mount Gerizim. And due to this hatred, some even believed that Luke's phrase, "the one who had mercy on him," may indicate a reluctance by Luke to even include the Samaritan in his gospel, even include the name. But this shows us clearly that God can use anything or anyone to bless you. He could use someone on a job who didn't like you to be the one to turn into your biggest advocate. He can use the one who once talked about you to become the one who's speaking up for you. Or the job that once let you go or did not give you your fair shot would be the one offering you an increase and begging for you to return. Y'all don't believe me by just saying that. Let me give you my own personal testimony. Years ago, I was a top performing rep at Bank of America, but I was grossly underpaid and overlooked for promotions. There was a leader who was caught saying that I don't deserve it, probably because I was a black man in my early 20s at a time when there was no other young African-American leaders in the district. So I eventually then left and found a job that offered me a higher position and gave me a 50% increase in my salary. I get happy just thinking about that. But though it was good, I eventually ended up leaving and returning back to Bank of America, not because anything was wrong, but because the same institution that once had someone holding me back now offered me an additional 50% on top of what I just received to return. The message for some of you is that when it is that God has called you to something, that there is no hate that can overpower God's favor. I like that. Let me repeat that. There is no hate that can overpower God's favor. There is no attack that can keep you down, and there is no one hand needed to place you where you need to be. Where you are and who's around is exactly what you need to get what God has for you. He put this man on his donkey. The Samaritan didn't just help him up, but the Bible tells us that he had compassion for him. So not only did he help him up, but he went and bandaged his wounds, poured on oil and wine. And he set him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The wine containing alcohol had an antiseptic effect on this man's wound, and the oil helped to soothe the wound and ease the pain. But to set him on his own donkey meant that the Samaritan then himself walked. He brought the man on a path from where he was and guided him to where there was help. See, it's one thing to fix an issue, but it's another to work toward a solution. For some of us, the story is that we've been masters at resolving issues, but leaving problems there. What would have been the outcome of the story if he just picked the man up, but left him there? We go through the argument, but we haven't solved the issue. I give once to feel good for the year, but I refuse to be consistent at helping others. I do one good deed, but the rest of the month, I'm only caring about myself. I ask for forgiveness, but I didn't remove myself to prevent falling to it again. Well, I help you with the task, but I won't allow, I won't show you how to do it for yourself because you might threaten my position. There's a danger in being issue fixers, but not solution finders. Have to have it in you to say that, no, I'm not just going to deal with it right now, but I'm going to ensure that I move past it. I'm not just going to help you here, but I'm going to ensure that I do what I need to do to lift you up as I climb. Last thing in this text that blessed me, I don't preach long when I'm preaching in front of the computer desk. Maybe when I get to the Met, I'll preach for an hour and a half. Last thing in this text that blessed me was the fact that he left the man there in the inn with money. He paid his rent by giving 2 denarii, which was about 2 weeks worth of rent, and gave him a promise to send more when needed. What he did was he created a highway. A highway, as we know, is a main road, especially one connecting major towns or cities. And he said, not only do I want to help you, but I want to help you to help someone else. And when it is that you commit to being a blessing, you may bless one person who in turn will now bless another person. That you may invite one person to church or to the stream who will in turn share and invite somebody else to church. You may tell one person about Jesus who will then get so excited about this newfound love that they'll then tell everybody else about Jesus. That's why the Bible tells us that one can chase 1,000, but 2 can put 10,000 to flight. That we are called to get through our path, to not only create trials, but to also inspire the flow of the highway. Now I can hear someone saying, wait, hold on, Pastor. If Jesus knew about this, then why didn't he just block it? And as I looked at this, I had the question as well, but I found it interesting that this man did not complain not once in this text. Even though we can argue that he was being directed by God, our paths, our steps are being ordered by the Lord. I believe that he didn't complain because he knew all along that God was in control. That he may have known that God won't put more on me than I can bear. So if I can just get through this journey, there's a blessing waiting for me on the other side. And through this journey, he not only got his rent paid for 2 weeks, but the man said, I'll return and pay the rest. And for some of you, the word that I have for you is that this year you've lost some stuff. This year you have been through so much during this time of quarantine. You have dealt with this season of uncertainty, that this year already you may have had people who left you, may have had some friends who you thought would be there that turned around and turned their back against you, and may have felt as if the enemy has been beating you emotionally and spiritually. That God is saying that what's on the other side is a blessing that's so great that it exceeds all that you could even ask or think. You just have to trust that God sees and knows all about your journey. This is now my third time saying it, so I'm serious. I'm about to go back to my couch. But before I do, I got to tell you this story. It was months ago, before quarantine. Before there was fear of going to the airport and flying, when the world was to normal in the way that we knew it, just about 9-10 weeks ago, and I was on an airplane traveling, and I was seated across apparently a race car driver, and another guy on the left of me who recognized this driver and asked him for an autograph. Now I'm not into race car driving. If it ain't basketball or football, I probably am going to have a hard time knowing who you are. But he then asked him a question as they talked with me sitting in the middle across. I wanted to say something, but God is still working on me. So I proceed to let them have the conversation. But he then asked them, how do you trust racing that fast? The driver said to them that I can race at about 120 to 140 miles per hour without fear of crashing because I trust the man speaking into my headphones from the booth above. That I trust him because that man sees the track from a higher angle than I. And I have a word for maybe just about 25 of you possibly, that during this time of uncertainty, that you have to trust that God is still speaking. Trust that he's still leading you. Trust that he's still guiding you. Many have already wrote off the year 2020, but I believe that there's a few of you that's saying, yes, I'm dealing with this time of uncertainty. Things have been canceled. I don't have a graduation this year. I'm not working. I'm dealing with this season of loneliness because of social distancing, but I still trust that God is going to work things out, turn it around, and this will be one of the best years of my life. I know that's a bold statement, but there's a few of us who can say that I don't have to see the track. I just trust that God sees what I cannot see. And what's ahead of me is greater than what I can see before me, because I believe that God is working it out. Is there anyone in here who can say, if God has guided me through the path, if he allowed me to create the trail, I believe that now the highway is about to be created to where not only am I going to be blessed, but those around me are about to be blessed. And I have a word for a parent who may be praying for your young adult child. Just as my parents prayed for me when I was in jail, just as my parents prayed for me when I got kicked out of school, who's been asking God to turn it around. He said that you might be dealing with a time of uncertainty, but trust that I'm about to turn it around. Someone is dealing with uncertainty on your job. Someone is dealing with uncertainty within your circle of friends. God says that what's ahead of you is greater than anything that is not only behind you, but what I'm about to lead you to is greater than what you can see right now. I need just about 20 of you who knows that better days are on the way to just type in the comment section, better is on the way, who knows that God is turning situations around, to type in the comment section, better is on the way, who refuse to allow life to beat you up and you just lay there. But just like the man in our text, you're going to get up, and not only are you going to get up, but you're going to get up much better. I just can't leave it with this man in the text without mentioning one other person, because this other person They thought that it was over because on Friday night, they beat him down. On Friday night, he laid on the cross and then he died. And all day Saturday, they thought that it was over because he laid there. But early Sunday morning, not only did he get up, but he got up with all power in his hand. I came to tell someone that when you get up this time, that when you walk back into work this next time, that when you walk back into school this next time, you're going to walk in with more power than you had before. That you are not sheltered in place, but you are safe in place. Not only are you safe in place, but God is leading you and directing you to better. Somebody type better. I told you I had three times to say that, and now that's my third time. But I believe that there's someone here who's saying, Pastor, you were preaching out of the pages of the book of my life. Yes, I've been going through the path, or I've been on this trail, or I'm trying to create this highway. But you're saying that what I need to do, number one, saying that I need to give my life to Christ. And today is a day that you want to dedicate and commit your life to Christ. Secondly, there's someone that's saying that what I need to do is I need to rededicate, recommit my life to Christ. That I did give my life to him, but somewhere along the way, I messed up and lost my way. And I want to start this relationship over. Or third and finally, you may be saying that I just need to be a part of a church. Or you may be saying that I just need prayer to help me to get through this journey. If that is you, this prayer is for you. Lord God, I thank you for those who are making that commitment right now to dedicate their lives to you, to rededicate their lives to you. I'm praying for these people that give them strength to continue on this journey, that the road and the path won't be easy, but there were some who created a trail, and they have the testimonies that if God did it for me, he can do it for you. For those that are saying that, God, I'm making a declaration that I believe you died and rose again for me, that you would give them the encouragement needed to continue not only in this journey, but to do what you have called them to do. But God, there are some that are saying that I just need prayer to overcome what I'm facing. I'm praying that you strengthen them for what they're going through, to let them know that you won't put more on them than they can bear, and you haven't left them, because you will never leave nor forsake them. But on the other side of what they're going through, it's a blessing that's greater than what they could have asked or thought. But God, give us the strength needed to get to that place. This is my prayer, and by faith I believe it's done in Jesus' name. Amen. Maybe someone say that I want to be a part of a church, and I believe that the Met is my church, that this can be my church home, and even virtually, I want to join up with the Met. I'm going to ask that you send them a DM, send them an email, and let them know that I want this to be my church home. God bless you, and I love you. I pray for you. Please pray for me. Amen.
What a powerful word today. Thank you, Pastor Newton, for letting the Lord use you to bless us. I told you the preacher was a preacher. God bless him, and God bless his ministry. Now, my brothers and sisters, it's time for us to celebrate what the Lord has done for us, through us, and will do with us if we'll yield to his direction. It's time to give, and giving is always in order when the Lord bless us. We ought to be willing to bless. And so we've made several ways available to you for giving through the ministry of the Metropolitan Church. Of course, you can drop it in the mail, as many of our members do. You may feel free to use one of our online portals for giving, Give Plus or Cash App. Maybe you want to drop it by the church office through our secured receptacle there. Be glad to receive it there. Or maybe you want to call the office for one of the officers to pick it up. Either way you choose, I only challenge you to do one thing before you give. I challenge you to pray. For if you pray, I can guarantee two things. You'll never give too much, and you'll never give too little. I'm getting ready to write my check, fill my envelope out, and won't you join me as we partake of this opportunity to give? And as we're doing it today, the marvelous voices of our Yakum Choir from the Midwinter Meeting will again bless us in singing. Let's give. Amen.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. My name is Dr. Zalexa Rivera, and I'm the Eastern Region Yakum Chairperson. Special love and shout out to the host pastor, Reverend Dr. Terry L. Jones, Sr. It is my honor and privilege to be here today with you as a special guest for this fifth annual Yakum Epic Sunday. I am privileged to work with an amazing team, so special shout out to my brother, Terry Love Jones, Jr., for this invitation to be here with you today. Now, granted, we are virtual, but that's all right because, you know, we are millennials and we'll adapt to it. However, you know, it's just a time as this for us to bring ministry into the life of the church, and we're going to use all of our wonderful tactics to do it. So once again, it's an honor and privilege to be here with you today.
God bless you, and thank you for your time here with us today for this epic 2020 Sunday. We couldn't be more excited as this is our fifth annual epic, and look at what the Lord has done, even at such a time as this. So we're just so grateful. Another special thanks to Reverend Quavon Newton for your time and the word with us today. Another special thanks to Dr. Zalex Rivera for your presence and sharing with us. Reverend Wesley Dullivan, thank you again, brother, my special friend. We can't go without thanking our beloved pastor, the Reverend Dr. Terry L. Jones, Sr., my dad. I'm Brother TJ, Terry Jones, Jr., Director of Young Adults here at the Met. And once again, I am just ecstatic at what God has done here. And I am thankful to our Yakum at the Met for always coming through in the clutch and providing meaningful ministry to God's people. Thank you, young adults and other persons who have joined us for service today. Brother TJ here signing off, wishing you all a very beautiful, epic Sunday yourselves. God bless you.
Thank you for tuning into that wonderful, or should I say epic, worship service. Be sure to mark your calendars for the following opportunities later on today and in the week to engage in God's Word. Today, Sunday prayer service with Pastor at noon. Wednesday night prayer meeting is at 6 p.m. Then at 6:30, join us for the Hartford District Town Hall meeting and prayer call hosted by Presiding Elder, our very own Pastor Jones, and our special guests will be Bishop and Mrs. Dennis V. Proctor. Thursday night is Bible study at 6 p.m. and finish off the week with Saturday Sunday School at 1 p.m. All these events will take place virtually using the Metropolitan Standard Zoom information. Please join us if you can. Speaking of joining in, have you completed the 2020 census yet? There's so many important reasons to do so, but it isn't too late. Simply log on to 2020census.gov. Be sure you and your family are counted. Please also keep our sick and shut in your prayers. Our members who are ill or mourning the losses of family members, this time it's not easy for us, but we need to keep those individuals lifted. Those are your announcements for this epic Sunday. Have a great week.
Thank you so much, Sister Ayana, for sharing with us our notices, our concerns for this week. And I hope you'll make yourself a part of what's going on here virtually through the Ministry of Metropolitan. Thank you, Dr. Zalex, for being with us to bring greetings from the Eastern Region. In fact, thank all of our young adults for their participation today. They have indeed made this service rich, and they have made us aware that they are not the church of tomorrow, they are the church of the day. Thank you so much for all of your sharing. And so now, my brothers and sisters, it's time to go. But we leave this place, but never the presence of our God. Would you look with me to the Lord now as we shall be dismissed? Oh, by the way, do not forget our announcements, the notices that Ayala shared, our ways of giving that was shared, and other information will be scrolling at the end of the broadcast so that you can take note of those things as they will affect us in the days and weeks ahead. Amen. And now may we look unto the Lord. And now may grace, peace, truth, and love from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost be with us and remain with us always, now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let us all say amen, amen, and amen.
Hallelujah. Him. I said, hallelujah. I just tell you to take just a minute or so and just raise the roof in this place. Shout on the God with a voice of triumph.